Zero trust in a cloud-first world. That's the topic of this latest To The Point webcast. Hello and welcome. I'm Maggie Miller, here with a panel of experts to share their insights today on zero trust. So let's welcome them. First, we have Chris Hellenbeck. He is the CISO of the Americas at Tanium. Welcome, Chris.
Great to be here, Maggie.
We also have Brian McKee. He is the Director of Product Management at Tanium. Welcome, Brian.
Hey, Maggie. Great to be here.
And we also have Sharat Ganesh. He is the Director of Technical Product Marketing at Tanium. Welcome, Sharat.
Real pleasure, Maggie. Thank you.
Well, I'm looking forward to this discussion today. So let's dive right in. Chris, first, what is zero trust and why should people care about it?
So zero trust is a concept that's been around for a while and building momentum. It's an idea that really you can't trust anything in your network because there might already be an intrusion you don't know about. Whether that's a compromised system or a compromised set of credentials from a user. So the idea is I'm going to revalidate that user at every time they try and access a particular piece of information or system. And that way I can control the risk to my systems.
And the pandemic has caused so many more issues with cybersecurity over the last year. In particular, the US government and healthcare have been among the biggest targets. So Brian, what do you think made these organizations so vulnerable?
You know, Maggie, as I think about that and the potential of what causes it, you look at those two types of organizations and those are organizations that traditionally have the vast majority of their users sitting on premises. And you immediately shifted a whole bunch of employees to work from home in, you know, conditions that weren't really set up for that, right? And so they're scrambling and getting users online was more of a concern than the security that went behind making sure that as they got online, that they were doing so in a manner that kept the organization safe and secure.
Yeah, and Sharat, so how should customers think about validating the security of their enterprise risk with vendors in the supply chain?
Well, that's a really, really tough problem. And what happened with SolarWinds last year and the domino effect that followed really showcased the drastic consequences of what happens when a third-party supplier gets breached. It all comes down to what has traditionally been a problem which our customers and various IT leaders have historically faced is the push and pull between regular business operations and security. More often than not, procurement was often seen as an impediment towards implementing projects and realizing a faster time to value. You know, and validating third-party supplier risk became just a point-in-time assessment. So that obviously cannot sustain going forward. So I fundamentally believe like three things needs to happen, right? One is it has to be continuous iterative process. You have to evaluate third-party supplier risk on an ongoing basis and go beyond the scope of just regulations, right? Or audit the software coding practices, you know, manufacturing controls, et cetera. Secondly, zero trust has to be the norm, right? Enforce policies internally on the flow of data to and from crown jewels. And you know, make sure you have controls around identity, network segmentation, and device posture data. And finally, this is the most important, right? Do the basics right, patching, vulnerabilities, and make sure you have a strong detection and response program. So if a breach does happen, you have the tools and the processes in place to limit the consequences of the breach.
Yeah, I like that advice, getting back to the basics. So now let's shift the discussion a little bit to talk about the challenges and some of the benefits of zero trust. Chris, I'm curious, as we're heading into this new year, what are the top security challenges for CISOs?
So I think that some of those challenges are continuations from last year, and it'll just continue to build. Part of it is something that Brian had hit on, you know, people working from home, this now new hybrid world of things. There's going to be devices in the mix that aren't a part of their traditional asset management. So they need to understand what those devices are, where they are, the security posture of them, what software is on those systems, all of those things. But also as they moved into this new world, they adopted a lot of cloud offerings, usually to facilitate remote work. And so they now have to manage a lot more things that are out there in the cloud, plus the on-prem things. And so they've got this world where they have to reconcile the two. I think that's gonna be one of the biggest challenges is they need to get their arms around this new world while not forgetting about the old things that they have in their environments.
Yeah, and Brian, can you talk a little bit about some of the challenges with the zero trust model approach?
Yeah, you know, and you know, Chris kind of alluded to it. Is you know, they you know, organizations started to adopt cloud first technologies and started to change the kind of shape and the way that they access data and resources. I would say one of probably the biggest challenges to that is there's kind of two. One is you try to do too much of it too fast, right? You need to take measured approaches and do things systematically and programmatically, right? So that you have a plan. You know, Sharat mentioned, you know, when intrusions happen, how do you detect them? And zero trust is, you know, it doesn't change that intrusion is going to happen. It just shifts where it could happen from. And then really the other is if you keep the same processes, if you've changed the fundamental way your network is structured and the way it looks and the way users access data, and you maintain and keep the same processes that you've had, you're not really opening yourself up for the opportunity to be successful.
I think, Brian, like I had a conversation with a customer earlier, and they were mentioning that earlier they used to have an 80-20 model for their VPN infrastructure where 80% of the employees were on-premise in the office inside walled and 20% were remote globally. It's completely flipped to about 100% remote. So the VPN infrastructure is not able to scale to the new demands, the new world, and CIOs have now rationalized their existing investments and plan for the future and the scale at the same time.
Yeah, and you know, zero trust is not something that's going to happen overnight. It's a journey, as we've talked about before. So how can companies embark on this zero trust journey, Chris? Any like starter tips?
Well, like I said, anything that they've done in the cloud environment is going to be a more likely candidate. A cloud-first model where any new thing that you're adopting, any new projects you're taking on, look towards a cloud environment first. Usually they're instrumented better to enable you to make these types of decisions, integration with CASB solutions and things of that sort, so that you can have the access control decisions that you need. Legacy applications are going to be more of a challenge in that space. So pick something relatively easy, get a win. It doesn't have to be your most critical application. Sometimes your most critical application is going to be the one that is more fine-grained and more opportunities to trip you up. So pick something simple, start there, get confidence, and build momentum as you go.
Yeah, I like that advice, start small. And so Sharat, what is Tanium doing to solve these problems with zero trust?
Yeah, quite a bit actually. But let's take perspective of where it stands today, right? So like zero trust has historically, and even today, focuses on user identity management and network level segmentation. Most organizations don't have visibility to the operational state of the endpoint. It is absolutely fundamental the organizations have visibility not into the user that's trying to access the data, where the data resides, but also the device, the posture of the device, both from a security and operational standpoint of the connecting device coming to the organization. Given the state of the world today, a lot of the employees are also leveraging their own personal devices, which are not company standard issued. Right, so you have to make sure that the device that is connecting is up to date on its security parameters. It is up to date on its vulnerabilities and patches. So what Tanium is doing is it's providing the most authentic, consistent, real-time data at scale on the various operational management and security indicators of the endpoint trying to connect. So we are partnering with various IAM, CASB, and proxy vendors to leverage this high fidelity Tanium endpoint indicator data and use that as a decision point to provide access. Just to give a quick couple of examples, we have partnered with Google BeyondCorp and Cloudflare One, and they're leveraging real-time endpoint security indicators from Tanium as a decision vector to provide access to their crown jewels.
Before we wrap up this webcast, just want to get your final thoughts on zero trust. So Chris, tell us, what are your takeaways for the audience today?
Well, again, it's a journey, more like a marathon, not a sprint. But also you're gonna have to do some care and feeding. You know, you don't get to plant a garden and walk away from it. You do have to do occasional weeding. And part of that weeding in this case is taking away access. As people change job roles, as they progress in their career, they move on to other projects, you do have to remove that access. Part of this is deciding what should people be able to access as a part of their job? and then yes, removing it when they don't need it. And that's a part that people just, they want to see a silver bullet, but this is like anything else. There's care and feeding.
Yeah, Brian, what are some of your words of wisdom today?
You know, almost piggybacking on Chris's statement is it's not just the technology and the people that you look at and the care and feeding of that, but it's also the process, right? Your processes are going to change. You're going to learn things. You're going to learn that users access data in ways that you didn't really know that they did because you didn't have visibility or insight into that. And as you move and you start to, you know, migrate applications to the cloud or change the way people go to access those resources and that data, it's going to expose how people actually use it and what they're using it for. And so I think you have to continually look at your processes and where can we become more efficient? Where can we become better? And at the end of the day, where can we provide more value to your customer? In that case, it's employees or whoever that is, as you enable them to do their job.
Yeah, Brian, I mean, you really can accelerate the business. I mean, once you get to understand the access flows, it's one central point to enable someone to access things, which in theory means you can onboard someone much faster.
And offboard them just as fast.
If need be. So Rob, what are your final thoughts and how Tanium can help maybe?
Firstly, copy whatever Chris and Brian said. Absolutely right. I agree with both of them. I think it's not an end state, right? It's an iterative process. It's a continuously improving field, you know, and things are adapting radically. If anything 2020 has taught us, things can have radical shifts in a matter of months, right? So have that organizational nimbleness to adapt to changing times. Make sure that you're not setting in stone deterministic milestones, but like making sure that you're meaningfully taking those small wins as Chris alluded to. Mm-hmm. And because, you know, the hackers are adapting too. The scale with which they are going to respond, you need to respond at that scale to make sure that you're always ahead, a step ahead of the curve. But have an iterative process, continuously improve over time. And it's not a destination, it's a journey.
Great. It's a journey. And that's what we want to leave people with. Thank you all again for your time today and your insights. I appreciate it. And thank you to the audience for watching. If you want to learn more about how Tanium can help with your zero trust problems, go to our website, tanium.com. From there, you can sign up for a 14-day free trial of Tanium. Thank you again for watching. I'm Maggie Miller, and this is To The Point.